Robert Jackson. He was born in South Africa and educated at schools here and in southern Rhodesia, after which he went to Oxford at the tender age of 18 and in the fullness of time became president of the Oxford Union and got a first class in modern history and was elected prize fellow of All Souls. He spent time in Brussels at the European Commission in the cabinet of Sir Christopher Soames and accompanied Soames as the last British governor of southern Rhodesia as his personal advisor. He became a member of the first directly elected European Parliament and an MP from 1983 to 2005, serving as Minister for Higher Education and Science, then for Vocational and Technical Education, and then for Public Administration and Science. He and his wife have a place here in Cape Town and visit regularly, 3 months a year. He recently spoke to the South African Institute of International Affairs on the future of the European Union, and in the previous year on the meaning of Brexit, so he expects that some of you may already know him. And those who don't will enjoy the lively discussion to come. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you very much for making a nice full hall. That really is rather nice to have. You've all got a copy of the synopsis of what I'm going to be saying, so you can sort of follow the logic as it goes, and you've also got scope to write down rude remarks in the margin. There will be plenty of time for discussion afterwards. I'm expected to speak for about 45 minutes, and we've got a two-hour session, so please feel free to pile in afterwards. So, forecasting the future is always a doubtful art, but I can lay claim to at least one correct prediction. Last July, I rejected the title for this talk proposed by the summer school, which was Britain After Brexit. No, I remember saying we can't be sure of that. Nevertheless, forecasting does have its uses. It's a kind of thought experiment whose claims cannot be disconfirmed in the present, but which can meanwhile at least help to provoke debate and focus discussion, which is what I hope to do today. In all this, we have to extrapolate from current trends, all the while bearing in mind the unforeseeability, not only of Donald Rumsfeld's unknown unknowns, but also of his known unknowns, such as, for example, the consequences of the next downturn in the global economic cycle, when it comes, and also of accidents of personality, such as whether Boris Johnson continues his present transition from Prince Hal to Prince Henry, or whether he will eventually be tripped up by the evident Falstaffian aspects of his character. But don't let's forget that Falstaff is probably the most loved character in English literature. It's in this spirit that I now address the question of Britain's future. My plan today will be to begin with reflections on some near-term and local questions, notably concerning the future of Britain's political parties, and also for the prospects of constitutional change, including the future of the British Union. And I'll then go on to reflect on such longer-term and more global questions as the prospects for the British economy, for Britain's future interstate trading agreements, and for Britain's future place in global geopolitics. I will conclude with some well-meant advice for Remainers concerning how to live with Brexit. Last month's general election in Britain was a striking demonstration of how abruptly a political scene can change. Some of you may remember Harold Wilson's remark about a week is a long time in politics. 3 years of confusion resulting from the hung parliament elected in 2017, but now and suddenly the UK has what is surely the most solidly entrenched government in the Western world, with a probable life expectancy of more than 10 years ahead. Compare this with the impending breakdown of the governing coalitions in Germany, Italy, and Spain, the current very extensive civil disorder in France, and the constitutional struggle now underway in the United States. The Conservative Party now has both the opportunity and the incentive, strong incentive, to shift its centre of gravity from its former heartlands in the heavily capitalised south northwards and towards the undercapitalised, underinvested and long neglected regions of the English North and Midlands. What this will mean in practice remains to be worked out, but I have no doubt that an immense effort will be made, a point to which I will return when I discuss future economic developments. Meanwhile, let me situate this political development in its proper historical context. Much of the academic and journalistic commentary on Brexit has preferred to talk about what has happened in terms of a basically Marxist language borrowed from the continental politics of the 1920s and 30s, i.e. Brexit has been identified with fascism, populism, racism, and with a turn to the hard right. But if such commentary were more mindful of our own British political traditions, it might have noticed that we have been here before. In most of the 100 years that followed Disraeli's extension of the franchise to working men in 1867, and assisted by the extension of the vote to women by Conservative governments in the 1920s, the Conservative Party was kept in office largely by the votes of what was then known as the working class Tories, whence Lord Randolph Churchill's slogan of 1884, "Trust the people." Over that period, many of the seats which composed the so-called and now collapsed Labour Red Wall across the North and the Midlands were held by MPs from the party which has now recaptured them. During this period, a consistent reforming one nation policy was maintained by successive Tory prime ministers, from Lord Salisbury, who introduced the current system of local government, through Balfour, introducing national state secondary education, Baldwin, initiating regional policy, and Chamberlain, who initiated national housing and health policies. This was also the line pursued in the 1950s by Churchill and Macmillan. But in the 1960s, it encountered the severe problems occasioned by the post-war onset of economic globalization, leading to the shift overseas of many of the older first and second generation manufacturing industries which had first arisen in Britain. Cutting loose from those industries required the painful surgery administered by Mrs. Thatcher in the 1980s. This process was obviously very painful for many in the deindustrializing areas, but the general election vote last month in those same areas suggests that the scars from this hurt may be healing, and that the Conservative Party may now be able to revert in the rest of the 21st century to that policy and style which enabled it to function as the British party of government through much of the 20th century. So, to be blunt, while it may be more exciting to align Boris Johnson with Mussolini and even with the Nazis, it will, I think, turn out to be more accurate, though perhaps rather less exciting, to align him rather with Harold Macmillan, and even, though I dare hesitate to mention it, with Michael Heseltine. Turning now to the Labour Party and the Liberal Democrats, it seems to me that Labour is now facing its greatest crisis since its refoundation just over a century ago in 1918. This crisis can be encapsulated in a single statistic, which I put in the synopsis. In the two most recent general elections, a substantially higher proportion of the so-called working class voted for the Conservative rather than the Labour Party. In the election last month, these proportions were respectively 48% and 33%. The Labour Party structure that was put in place in 1918 was one in which political leadership was supplied by often quite far-left intellectuals in and outside Parliament to vast numbers of members principally recruited and led by a series of powerful and on the whole quite moderate trade union leaders. This system was undermined in the 1960s and 70s by the same forces of deindustrialization which also brought about, at least for a time, the occlusion of working class Toryism in the North and in Scotland. Overall, in this period, trade union membership shrank and the centre of gravity in the unions shifted to white-collar workers, mostly in the public services, and with the leadership, which is now much more left-wing. After the electoral disaster in 1983, resulting from Michael Foot's shift to the left, Tony Blair was able, in the mid-1990s, to pull off what seemed at the time to be a spectacular takeover of his much-reduced party by a posse of more modern types, drawn from the newly emerging trades of public relations, advertising, the media, and political consultancy. But this undoubtedly worthy attempt to relocate Labour at the centre of British politics eventually ran into the ground under Gordon Brown, and by a series of the kind of small mistakes that can so often bring about a mighty ruin, Jeremy Corbyn was able to secure election to the leadership of the party in 2015. He will soon take his leave, but even if a knighted lawyer succeeded him, and the Labour Party, it always seems to be a him, it seems likely that momentum and Corbynism will continue to dominate the party on the ground. Of them, it may justly be said with Talleyrand on the Bourbons, they have learned nothing and forgotten nothing. Because this will not be a winning formula, I would expect yet another comeback on the part of the ever-hopeful Liberals, perhaps reinforced by Labour defectors aiming to establish a new political force along Blairite lines in the centre and on its left. Lots of us would wish this venture well, but it would be unrealistic to think that it would take less than 10 years either to revive and renew the Labour Party or else to clear away its debris. Remember that it took Labour 14 years to win again after its defeat in 1983. Meanwhile, any new centrist grouping must face the danger of being captured by London-centred woke cosmopolitans whose lack of serious contact with the thought worlds of ordinary people have been so spectacularly exposed by the Brexit experience. Meanwhile, there's no doubt that this Brexit experience has been something of a trial for the British Constitution. The divisions about how and indeed whether to deal with the unexpected outcome of the 2016 EU referendum were all too accurately reflected in the hung parliament, which was produced by the 2017 general election. But these controversies have now been settled by last month's general election, which was in effect a decisive ratification by the electorate of its vote in 2016 to leave the European Union. Meanwhile, I think it is worth noting that throughout this difficult period, Parliament has lived up to its historical role as the cockpit for national political debate, and that at every step, the crucial decisions about Britain's future have been made by way of democratic, electoral, and parliamentary processes. Cast a cold eye for a moment on the scene on the other side of the English Channel, and contrast this situation with the ongoing, persistent, and underlying problem of governability in France. Having said this, however, the wranglings of the past 3 years have thrown up a number of issues concerning the future of Britain's constitutional arrangements, which I will now address. I will look first at the problem of what I will call judicial overreach, and then at the question of the future of the British Union in Scotland and Northern Ireland. The British Constitution has a long historical track record of success in sustaining governmental legitimacy by responding energetically to significant shifts in public sentiment. Note here three big words which I suggest are fundamental in respect of any political constitution, that is to say, legitimacy, responsiveness, and energy. Legitimacy refers to the practical consent of the governed to the arrangements by which they are governed. Sustaining this has been the central feature of British constitutional history since at least 1660, the Restoration, and perhaps even since the break with Rome in the 1530s, when the Crown called on Parliament to endorse its policy. In historical retrospect, it is clear, I think, that a serious problem of legitimacy was raised by the vote of the House of Commons in 1972 with a cross-party majority of only 8 votes for British entry into the then European community. A consequence of this problem was the first ever British referendum in 1975, intended to secure such legitimacy for our participation in what was then referred to as the common market. Since then, we've had a series of referenda, each concerning proposals for basic long-term changes in the form of government, and each designed to underwrite the popular legitimacy of those changes. There have been four of these referenda in Scotland and Wales, one in Northern Ireland, one in the English North East, together with two more UK-wide referenda, one on changing the electoral system, that was 2011, and the other in 2016, on whether we should continue to participate in the process of ever closer union, quote unquote, in what had by now become the European Union. Thus, it is obvious that the principle of the grounding of legitimacy by means of plebiscite has now become an important new feature of the British constitutional landscape. A first conclusion I draw from this fact is that we will need now to devote some serious thought to the question of the conditions for holding such referenda. For example, should there be an entrenched rule concerning the reopening of questions purportedly settled by a previous referendum? Should the losers be bound by their promises, in the words of Nicola Sturgeon 2 years ago, that this or that referendum will settle the question for a generation? My other two requirements for a successful constitution are responsiveness and energy. The capacity of our constitutional system to respond energetically to the results of the 2016 referendum were markedly damaged by two very recent constitutional innovations. In 2010, an element in the rushed deal to set up the Cameron-Clegg coalition government was the ill-considered legislation providing for a fixed 5-year term for every parliament. And in 2017, the very recently created Supreme Court, in the Miller case, overturned the long-established principle that the framing of interstate treaties is the prerogative of the executive, subject only to the continuing confidence of Parliament. Over the past 3 years, both of these constitutional innovations have been proved to be highly damaging, and I think they should now be reversed. Moreover, the decisions made by the Supreme Court in the context of Brexit raise a wider and more fundamental question, that of judicial overreach. This question was extensively discussed in last year's Reith lectures by Lord Sumption, recently retired from the Supreme Court. In particular, he remarked on how the development of judicial review, together with the judicial application of internationally codified human rights, were leading to the increasing judicialization of issues which should be more properly treated as political and electoral questions. I agree with Sumption's analysis, and I hope that the new government and parliament will think seriously about it. With regard to human rights, I observe that after Brexit, we will have shuffled off one of the two vexatious recent international codifications, that of the EU's Charter of Fundamental Rights. But that this still leaves in place our commitment to abide by the rulings of the even more remote Strasbourg Court and its European Convention on Human Rights. I believe that serious thought should now be given to reviving the Conservative election pledge of 2015 to replace this with our own British Bill of Rights, in respect of which judicial rulings should be advisory rather than declarative and determinative. Indeed, I think that a fundamental review is in order of Tony Blair's rushed and ill-considered decision in 2005 to set up the new so-called Supreme Court, with its pretensions to function as an ultimate constitutional instance in a state which does not in fact have a written constitution for such a Supreme Court to interpret. A start might be made by adopting a recent proposal from an Oxford law professor that this court should be appropriately named as the Upper Appeal Court. Or perhaps it might simply revert to its original 6-century-old status as the Appellate Committee of the House of Lords. Having got this off my chest, I turn to the perhaps more pressing question of the future of the British Union after the UK's withdrawal from the European Union. The contrasts in the 2016 referendum between the Leave majorities in England and Wales and the Remain majorities in Scotland and Northern Ireland must evidently raise some questions concerning the future of the British Union after Brexit. But note that at the recent election, the SNP won only 45% of the vote, which is actually less than the proportion who voted for independence in 2014. I foresee three possible scenarios. One, Westminster refuses its consent to the holding of referendum in both countries. Or two, Westminster allows such referenda and they fail in one or both instances. Or three, separate referenda in Northern Ireland and Scotland yield majorities for one or both of them to leave the UK. With regard to the first scenario, the legal position is that Westminster consent is required for the holding of a second NDREF in Scotland, and the SNP has, at least so far, ruled out attempting to mount a unilateral referendum. In respect to Northern Ireland, the single sentence on this matter in the Good Friday Agreement says nothing about the arrangements governing a referendum on leaving the UK, except that it envisages it as an all-Ireland process. In practice, it is clear that in respect of both Scotland and Northern Ireland, referenda can only take place with Westminster consent, which will probably not be given in this Parliament, or probably indeed in the next, unless, to put it bluntly, the British government is confident that they can be safely won for the Union. Meanwhile, with regard to the way in which such referenda might unfold, I would make three points. First, the financial consequences for both countries of leaving the UK would be very serious, however velvet the terms of any divorce might be. The annual fiscal transfer from the rest of the UK to Northern Ireland amounts to some £5,000 per head, larger than the transfers to any other region, with Scotland the next biggest recipient. Moreover, the UK annual public spending runs to more than £11,000 per capita in both countries. If they were to cut their ties to the UK, both Scotland and Northern Ireland would thus find themselves confronted by the need to make massive budgetary cuts and massive tax increases. Indeed, the Scottish financial position is already very vulnerable, as I point out in the synopsis. With a tenth of the UK's population, Scotland currently incurs more than half of the UK's total government borrowing, with an annual budget deficit running at 7% of GDP, greater than that of Italy and Greece. Dublin is not in a position to replace London as a source of funding for Northern Ireland, and it is probable that an independent Scotland within the EU would, like Ireland, find itself in the position of paying considerably more into the EU budget than it receives from it. In short, neither Scotland nor Northern Ireland are in the same financial position in relation to the UK as, for example, Catalonia is in relation to Spain. Catalonia is Spain's most prosperous region, making financial net fiscal transfers to the rest of Spain. Note this, that behind all the rhetoric of Catalonian nationalism, this is one of the rather selfish motives behind their drive to secession. In contrast, and speaking very bluntly, Northern Ireland and Scotland are poor relations within the United Kingdom, and the beneficiaries of enormous net fiscal transfers from the rest of the nation. Moreover, exit from the common and single market of the United Kingdom would have very serious consequences for the economies of both Northern Ireland and Scotland, both of which are much more deeply integrated within the UK market than they are or would be likely to be within the European Union's common and single market. Currently, some 60% of the exports of both Northern Ireland and Scotland go to the rest of Britain, compared with only 20% to the EU. The economic damage here might, or again it might not, be mitigated by the terms of any future free trade agreement between the UK and the EU. But one thing is for sure, on joining the European Union, both Scotland and Northern Ireland, having joined with the Republic, would be obliged to join the European Monetary Union, with potentially disastrous consequences for the price of their exports into the UK market. Now, you may perhaps be thinking that this parade of dreary statistics and economic prognoses will not be very effective. Remember what happened in the 2016 referendum. When it's faced by a rising tide of nationalist emotion, and so it may well be. But remember here that while the people of both Scotland and Northern Ireland have a romantic streak, both are notorious for financial hard-headedness. Given time for post-Brexit tempers to cool and for the economic and financial facts of life to be made clearer, I think that in any referendum, they would opt for the caution of the status quo. It is also as well to remember that in the 2014 referendum in Scotland, the romantic case for the United Kingdom as a considerable part, the romantic case for Scotland as a considerable part of one of the world's most considerable historical nation states was hardly articulated by tone-deaf and tongue-tied Labour politicians who ran the campaign to stay in the Union. The result was that the nationalists had all the best tunes. But after Brexit, much of this inhibition on the UK side in projecting British patriotism will be removed. The campaign to keep Scotland in its ancient union with England will be led by people with a much stronger sense of the emotional ties that bind than was articulated by the Remainers in Scotland in 2014, and indeed by their counterparts on the losing side in the 2016 EU referendum. I'm now going to talk a bit about the economy. It would require another talk to do justice to the obviously vital question of Britain's economic prospects post-Brexit. But since there's no time for this, I'll confine myself to a series of headline points. A first observation is that just as Brexit has demonstrated the resilience of the British political and constitutional system, so it has also demonstrated the resilience of the British economy. A striking feature of the past 3 years of Brexit turmoil and uncertainty has been Britain's continuing relatively strong economic performance. Over this period, we've had record levels of employment, 76.2% of our population have jobs, way ahead of the rest of Europe, increasing real wages, and continuing relatively high levels of foreign direct investment. Noted in the past 5 quarters, the UK economy grew by 1.1%, while the German growth rate fell to 0.05%. And contrast all this with the dire predictions of the Remain campaign. In fact, this contrast is one of the reasons why pro-Brexit sentiment remained firm in the face of all the expert opinion. In terms of GDP size, on a standardized basis, the UK currently has the 6th largest economy in the world. Its relative size has been declining, but in absolute terms, Britain remains one of the most economically dynamic of the mature economies, as can be seen by comparing annual rates of growth. The USA is the most dynamic of the mature economies, but since 1980, the UK has almost matched its score. Between 2009 and 2018, the UK's annual growth rate of 3.7% was just ahead of that of Germany at 3.5% and well ahead of France on 2.2%. Over this period, the British economy has grown in size by 45%, compared with only 9% in Italy, caught as it is in the turmoils of an unaffordable monetary union. An important factor in the UK's relative economic dynamism is that it is one of the most globally connected of the mature economies, with a higher proportion of its exports and imports than any other European country going to and coming from markets outside the EU. This is significant because these markets are growing much faster than those of the EU. This is why the proportion of UK exports going to the rest of the world has risen from 45% in 2006 to 56% in 2016. This despite having tariff-free access to the EU and being exposed to WTO exports, tariffs on exports elsewhere. As well as having a number of serious weaknesses, to which I will turn in a moment, the British economy has a number of important relative strengths. These include, since last month's general election, a government with secure prospects of continuance, probably for at least another 10 years. Second, the continuing global role of London in financial and other services, forming a critical mass which cannot be matched anywhere else in Europe. Third point is the relative size and strength of the British science and technology base. Despite dire predictions of the impact of Brexit, investment in the UK tech sector is continuing to rise from $5.2 billion in 2018 to more than $11 billion last year, well ahead of Germany on $5.4 billion and France on $4.8 billion. The UK currently has the largest number of unicorns in Europe, i.e. £1 billion venture capital-based tech companies. There are 29 of these in Britain. Fourth, among the mature economies, the UK is relatively advanced, perhaps too advanced, maybe we all went too fast with this, in the transition from the old first, second, and third generation industries to a diversified range of higher value-added industries and services based on new science, e.g. pharmaceuticals, computing, artificial intelligence, etc. And fifthly, and I think perhaps most remarkably, over the past decade, the UK supply of offshore wind energy has risen by a factor of five. And over the next decade, the UK will have installed sufficient wind power in the North Sea to supply more than 30% of our energy requirements at relatively low cost and on a renewable and sustainable basis. An example here, perhaps, for South Africa. Compare this with the situation only 10 years ago, only 10 years ago, when the contribution of wind and solar power to our energy supplies was relatively negligible. Over against these strengths, the British economy also has some significant weaknesses. Probably the most important of these is the relatively poor performance outside our world-leading elite educational institutions of much of our state-run primary and secondary schooling, and of our arrangements for vocational and technical further education. However, with the right policies and in the right political conditions, which have now perhaps at last arrived, it should be possible to make quite rapid improvements in these areas. An example of this is the effect of the Cameron government's insistence on a return to traditional methods for teaching reading. This was hotly contested, by the way, by all the experts. But after only 5 years, there were in 2016 some 147,000 more six-year-olds who were fluent readers. Another and larger instance of rapid improvement in education performance has been the rise in the rate of participation in tertiary education in the UK, from less than 10% of our young people in 1980, one of the lowest in the advanced economies, to more than 50% in 2018, one of the highest. I hope and expect that one of the consequences of the shift of attention to the needs of the North and the Midlands that will follow this general election will be an intense focus on technical and vocational upskilling in those areas. Another weakness is the relatively poor state of transport infrastructure, especially in the North and the Midlands, and also broadband infrastructure. But here again, I think the political stars are coming into alignment. Meanwhile, in a middle and longer term perspective, a major problem for Britain, as well as for most other advanced economies, will be demographic, i.e. a relentless increase in the proportion of the elderly in our population, we can all feel for that, until a new equilibrium at a lower population size, we won't be around for that, is reached by the end of the century. The indications are that the UK will be less seriously affected by this than many of our competitors. Our population of working age is forecast to continue growing quite robustly, while that of Japan has already fallen quite dramatically by more than 10 million, and equally substantial falls are also expected, especially in Italy and Germany. In fact, on some forecasts, Germany will have a smaller population than Britain by the second half of this century. All this means that continuing immigration into the UK will be necessary, but after Brexit, this process will be subject to politically accountable national control. Finally, in this catalogue of the UK's relative economic weaknesses, let me refer to the immediate problems posed by our departure from the EU, notably in respect of the automotive, aviation, and pharmaceutical industries, which are currently organised on the basis of the hassle and cost-free movement of parts across national borders within the EU. The automotive industry in particular remains important to the UK, though it accounts for only 0.8% of our GDP, in contrast with Germany, where it's 4% of GDP. While the advent of electric and hydrogen-powered automotives is likely to change the automotive scene quite radically over the next decade or so, its immediate future is clearly a very serious problem, both for the UK and for the EU. In this context, I think that the key point to note is that this is a problem for both sides. For the EU, and especially for Germany, the UK is its second biggest market for automotives after the United States. And given the fragile state of this sector across Europe, and particularly in Germany, the EU will have a strong interest in reaching an amicable accord with the UK. This thought brings me to the question of the forthcoming interstate trade negotiations between the UK and the EU, and indeed also between the UK and the USA, and between the USA and the EU. You'll notice that I referred specifically to interstate trade agreements, as distinguished from the myriads of agreements to trade between non-state, corporate, and individual actors. My point here is that it's simply false to assume that the economic relations between different countries are entirely or even mainly a function of the various governments' special trading agreements with other governments. As we've seen, the UK currently conducts more than half of its international trade under universal WTO rules, a proportion which has steadily increased over the past decade and a half as economic growth outside the EU has raced ahead of EU growth. Abrupt changes in the rules governing any international exchanges are, of course, liable to cause disruptions and should be avoided or minimized. But in respect of most of the goods and services traded by the UK, tariffs are not a major issue, and differences in regulatory standards can generally be adapted to by our exporters. Meanwhile, it's very important to grasp that the structures of all the advanced economies today seem to be on the cusp of very significant science-driven technological transformations, an example of that in the case of the energy sector. These should offer ample opportunities for the United Kingdom to continue to play a leading and profitable role. And in doing so, it is in Britain's interest to minimize its exposure to the European Union's regulatory system, which is strikingly cumbersome and excessively exposed to the power of protectionist vested interests. The debate about the interstate trading relations between the UK and the EU is fraught with talk of models. You will recall the Norway model, that is of the UK remaining in the EU customs union and single market, subject to the oversight of the European Court, and continuing to make a significant financial contribution to the European budget without participating in European decision making. It's odd to think that that idea was ever a runner, or that anybody could think, as some commentators perhaps still do, that Boris Johnson would be willing to settle for it. Then there is the Canada model of a comprehensive arm's-length free trade agreement in respect of trade in goods, no financial contributions, agreement to pursue equivalence in respect of regulatory standards, and with provision for reference to independent judicial review in disputed cases. You will also have heard of Canada Plus Plus, which involves, in the case of the UK and the EU, additional agreements on trade in services, not covered in the Canada deal, and also on security and defense cooperation. Canada Plus Plus seems to be the model indicated by the UK-EU withdrawal agreement, which provides for the swift negotiation of, quote, an ambitious trading relationship in goods on the basis of a free trade area agreement with a view to facilitating the ease of legitimate trade. Note that the agreement also indicates that, quote, it is the clear intent of both parties to develop in good faith agreements giving effect to this relationship such that they can come into force by the end of 2020, this year. The new Commission President, who's talking about delaying, Britain contributing £1 billion a month, would do well to remember this firm date already agreed by both sides. Meanwhile, let it also be noted that there is another possible model, less talked about because less favoured by the EU, which is that of the myriad ad hoc deals which have been negotiated over the years between the European Union and Switzerland. Switzerland is a country which is much smaller than the UK, but which has a very important economy and is also integral to the functioning of the European economy. And like Britain, it has a strong attachment to sovereign and accountable self-government. For what it's worth, my surmise is that if there is going to be a UK-EU agreement in the course of this year, and there may well not be, it will be one which is closer to the Swiss model than to any other, paving the way for further ad hoc arrangements in subsequent years and pending the much wider settlement of trading, defence and political relations between the USA, the EU and the UK, which I think will emerge in due course. An important complicating factor in all these negotiations concerns the process for the ratification of international agreements by the EU. It required something like 4 years for the EU to complete the ratification of the Canada-EU agreement by each of the 28 member state parliaments and also by a congeries of subnational parliaments. You may recall that the Canada deal was almost scuppered by opposition from the Parliament of Wallonia, the economically depressed French-speaking sub-region of Belgium. Recent European court judgments have, however, allowed for some streamlining by distinguishing between less ambitious arrangements, whose ratification need not involve all these various parliaments, and the more ambitious ones where this will still be required. I think that this factor by itself indicates that the journey which lies ahead of the UK and the EU will be made in a series of small, not very dramatic steps, rather than in one great leap. The basic objective of the British government in these upcoming negotiations will be to secure the greatest possible freedom of manoeuvre in the conduct of British policy as the country seeks to enhance its international economic competitiveness. Over against this, and Frau Merkel hinted at it just the other day, I think that the basic EU objective is to tie Britain as closely as it can into its regulatory system, thus restricting its potential competitiveness. In effect, and also I think by intention, as indicated by Mrs. Merkel. On this central question, it is hard to see how early agreement will be possible. Indeed, I think it will only be settled in the context of the new settlement in transatlantic relations, which I think is coming over the horizon. On the other hand, I believe that it may be possible to find some common ground between the UK and the EU, notably in respect of the ongoing operation of those key industries, which I've already mentioned, whose production processes have been organized on the basis of traffic across national borders within the pre-Brexit EU. These industries are very important for both sides, and it should accordingly be possible in the course of this year to conclude an agreement to enable those sectors to continue to flourish. After all, Airbus cannot be made without the wings and the engines made in Britain. Another area where some kind of limited agreement might be reached concerns financial and other services. This is the UK's strongest export suit, and in the aftermath of the referendum, a determined effort was made by the various financial centres on the continent and in Ireland to cash in on what they thought would be a catastrophe for the City of London. But these efforts have all flopped. I believe that so far no more than 7,000 jobs have been lost to London. Meanwhile, it may be hoped that a certain realism will be emerging in the EU side concerning their continued dependence on the resources of London and also of Zurich, and the dangers for them of damaging their own access to those central international markets, which taken together are twice as large as all the financial centres in the rest of the European Union. In all these discussions, a great deal will depend on whether the EU side seeks to overload any agreement with attempts to get the British government to commit to all kinds of regulatory alignments, which would in effect negate the primary purpose of Brexit, which was precisely to retrieve national sovereignty in such matters. Concluding this discussion of the impending UK-EU trade negotiations, it's important to understand that these will probably be conducted in parallel with similar negotiations between the United Kingdom and the United States. By way of a Russia-sponsored leak, which featured quite prominently in last month's general election, we know that a great deal of preparatory spadework has already been done between London and Washington. And I think that because of this, and because of their underlying philosophical similarities between the two countries, it is eminently possible that the outlines of a possible UK-USA free trade agreement may have been agreed before such agreement is reached between the UK and the EU. The EU might then have to face up to the, I think, alarming thought that it may not only lose its current privileged access to its second largest export market, but that much of this advantage, for example, in respect of agricultural exports, may further be transferred to the country which they currently regard as their most international, as their most serious international economic competitor. Meanwhile, the signs are that America's impatience with Europe's structural trade surpluses, its protectionism, and its free riding in matters of defense is beginning to run out. Hence my reference earlier to an impending new settlement in transatlantic relations. So these reflections on the ways in which UK, EU, USA interstate trading arrangements may work out over the period ahead lead naturally to my penultimate topic today. This concerns the place of Britain in the shifting balances of the global geopolitics of the next decade or so. Here I will refer both to the economic and industrial aspects and also to military aspects about which I so far said nothing. I think we can distinguish three distinct geopolitical scenarios, which I will call respectively multilateralism, multipolarity, and bipolarity. In the period since 1945, the military defense of the West has been based on the two American alliance systems, with NATO in Europe and with Japan, South Korea, and Australia and New Zealand in the Pacific. Meanwhile, the world economy has developed within the institutional framework set up by the United States and Britain at the end of World War II. This system is based on agreement between sovereign states to conduct their interstate political and economic relations within a structure of common rules operated by such global institutions as the United Nations, the World Trading Organization, previously the GATT, General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, and the IMF. In the second half of the last century, this dispensation delivered spectacularly on its wartime promises, leading by the end of the century to the collapse of the USSR and the Soviet bloc, and the entry into the multilateral system, first of the countries of the former Soviet Empire, and then of the People's Republic of China. 2001, China acceded to the World Trade Organization. This system is, however, currently in a great deal of trouble. The rapidity of the shift of much traditional manufacture to the emerging economies has led to politically unacceptable strains in the developed democracies, notably in the United States. And two major economies, China and Germany, have succeeded in erecting economic systems which deliver structural trade surpluses on a scale which is also politically unacceptable, not least to the United States, and especially to President Trump. At the same time, there is increasing irritation in the United States at what the Americans rightly see as the free rider approach of the Europeans, and again, especially of Germany, to the military defense of the West. This issue is going to become increasingly prominent as the Russians proceed with their current development of new short-range nuclear missile systems, which Europe by itself cannot counter, and which will therefore need to be met, if indeed it is going to be met, by a renewed American and British commitment to the defense of continental Europe. In respect of multilateralism, there are two views about Trump. On the one hand, that he is a wrecker out to destroy the system of multilateralism, both economic and defensive, and on the other, that the multilateral system has been abused, and that Trump is right to seek to correct those abuses. I incline to the unfashionable second view, to which I will return in a moment. My second scenario is that of multipolarity. The historical premise of multilateralism has been the unity of the West. But within that unity, there's always been an important dissension voice, that of France, especially after the return to power of General de Gaulle in 1958. A fundamental French thesis for decades has been that the world will be and should be organized on a multipolar basis, with the main poles being Europe, led of course by France, poised between the United States to the west, Russia to the east, and China in the Far East. This approach naturally has a following in Brussels, and it featured quite prominently in European polemics against Brexit, especially on the part of assorted Benelux world statesmen arguing that the world is devolving into continental-scale power blocks, and woe beside both the outsiders and the stragglers like poor old Britain. But the question poses itself of the realism of this European aspiration. As an economic pole, Europe is a declining factor. Its share of world GDP has fallen from 30% in 1970 to 16.28% in 2018, and by the mid-century it will probably be no more than 10%. There is an increasing imbalance of power between France and Germany, which prefers to keep its money in its own wallet and its head down, not least in military matters. And when push comes to shove, the East Europeans, like the British, are more inclined to look to Washington for defense than either to Paris or Berlin. At the same time, outside the EU, the question arises of the future of the Russian pole. With its nuclear weapons, Russia is a military giant, but its economy is considerably smaller than that of Britain. Russian GDP is currently about the size of that of Italy. In economic terms, Russia will probably find herself more and more caught up in the orbit of emerging China. This thought brings me to my third geopolitical scenario, that of what I will call bipolarity, acknowledging the unhappy implications of that term. What I have in mind here is a return to something like the East-West standoff of the Cold War period, but now with the main focus of rivalry being economic and technological rather than military, and with the two poles being the United States and the West on the one side, and China together with an increasingly dependent Russia on the other. The trend in this direction is already visible in the American campaign to exclude Huawei from Western markets. And I have to say that I think that this bipolarization is likely to become the dominant global geopolitical theme of the next couple of decades. But in the end, if we're lucky, this US-China standoff will end up in the same way as the earlier USA-USSR standoff, as the giant dictatorships totter on their feet of clay. What are the implications of all this for Britain? With its historic traditions of free trade, going back to Adam Smith in the 18th century, and the abolition of the Corn Laws in the middle of the 19th century, the UK has a good claim to be accounted the principal founder of 20th century multilateralism. And given the relative extent of our exposure to global markets, it may be said to have a greater interest in its successful future than any of the other great powers. Having said this, the other founder of post-war multilateralism has been the United States, and both the UK and the USA may be said to have suffered in the same ways from the abuses of the multilateral system which are reflected in the gigantic Chinese and German structural trade surpluses. Accordingly, I suggest that after Brexit, the UK should aim to resume its place at the side of the United States and the rest of the Anglosphere in promoting a renewal of multilateralism within the West, led by the United States, in the context of what is likely for some time to be an increasingly global, bipolar global scene. To sloganize in the manner preferred by the Chinese, our watchwords should be repair multilateralism and prepare for bipolarity. Finally, by way of conclusion, if not closure, I want to say a few words about how British Remainers, and any supporters they may have in this room, might learn to live with Brexit. A striking feature of the Brexit debate has been the passionate opposition to Britain's departure from the EU of so many British academics, intellectuals, and commentators on public affairs.
I saw yesterday that a reader in music at the Royal College of Music had put out a tweet to the effect that celebrating Brexit's exit on January the 31st would be the equivalent of Kristallnacht. Can you imagine a more deranged observation? I think it's not unfair to say that this opposition has been conspicuously negative rather than positive. It has been directed more against our departure from, quote, Europe, unquote, in inverted commas, rather than in favor of Europe as such. In fact, most Remainers, in my experience, have little knowledge of the workings of the EU and of the details of its institutions and policies. So what has been going on? One powerful analysis proposed by David Goodhart has sought to contrast, on the one hand, the somewhere people of Britain, those with local and national roots and local and national pride, and on the other hand, the anywhere people, i.e. those who are proud of transcending those roots and being capable of living anywhere. What Theresa May perhaps unfortunately referred to as citizens of nowhere. This phrase goes too far, but I do think there is some force in the contrast. But rather than developing this painful theme, I would like, perhaps more constructively, to point to another factor which I think is also important. It's a confusion in the minds of many Remainers between identity and citizenship. Over the past decade or so, identity politics have become a central theme in democracies across the world, not least here in South Africa. These putative identities are many and varied. They include, on the one hand, the personal identities of sexuality and gender, if that, such a thing exists, and on the other hand, the social and cultural identities of religion, ethnicity, and political ideology. I suggest that in the context of Brexit, the emotions of Remainers have been stirred up by the thought that a European identity, of which they'd previously hardly been conscious, was now being snatched away from them by fellow citizens in Britain who had no care for or even understanding of that identity. I can understand why such thinking should have provoked strong feelings. But I want to make two points which may help the Remain-minded to live with Brexit. The first is that identity need not be either a political or a zero-sum phenomenon. It's perfectly possible to identify with the Europe of, shall we say, Dante, Pascal, Goethe, Mozart, or merely of Mediterranean Dolce Vita, without this sense of cultural identity generating any kind of affiliation to a particular political or economic or social or constitutional project. Moreover, such a sense of cultural identity need not be exclusive of other kinds of identity, including one's identity as a national or local citizen. My second and perhaps more fundamental point is that identity is not the same as citizenship, a consideration which has perhaps been blurred by the EU's project of manufacturing a European citizenship, which is in fact entirely derived from the various national citizenships of the EU's member states. To be very blunt, an identity confers only rights, my right to my identity, with no reference to corresponding responsibilities and duties. But citizenship involves each and all of these things, including, notably, solidarity with one's fellow citizens, a common allegiance to the state of which one is a citizen, and a willingness to cooperate with majority decisions democratically arrived at. I guess that most of us in this room would probably describe ourselves as liberals. Certainly, I think of myself as a liberal conservative. What seems to have been forgotten by many Remainer liberals, and this is what caused the Liberal Democrats to do so badly in the general election and their leader to lose her seat, is that liberalism is above all and primarily not an economic doctrine or a set of social attitudes, but a political doctrine. It is a doctrine of democratic and accountable governance. It is a doctrine of trust the people. As my last word, let me recall a conversation I had, I vividly remember it, at a garden party in Oxford on a blazing summer afternoon in June in 1972 with a distinguished Norwegian law professor. Britain and Norway were both negotiating accession to the European communities. The Norwegians were holding a referendum at which they decided not to join. I asked the professor how he would vote, and when he told me that he was against joining, he volunteered the reason with an attractive Norwegian accent. It is because in Europe the rulers are too far from the ruled. The first step for Remainers in learning to live with Brexit might be to acknowledge the force of that pretty fundamental observation. Now we've got quite a bit of time for discussion. Who'd like to fire first? Well, I think the reason is it's partly because they are relatively economically deprived. Northern Ireland, of course, has been through a really terrible period of continuing struggling with radical Irish nationalism and terrorism, which has set it back quite a long way. It was also, of course, one of the main industrial areas in the first and second generation industries of Britain, which therefore suffered from deindustrialization. Scotland, similarly, suffered from deindustrialization. It's actually made quite a dramatic recovery from that. Edinburgh is second to London as the financial center of the EU. So it's partly that those two countries have objectively more serious problems than England, but less serious than Wales. Wales is rather lost out in all of this. And it's partly, I think, by dint of aggressive politics in Scotland, at any rate. The way in which Spurgeon carries on, you might think she's hardly noticed the fact that she's always asking for more of other people's money. People in England, on the whole, just don't even notice it, which is perhaps a bit of a pity. So I think that, in a way, they've sort of got away with it. But reality check is coming along. The SNP have been in power in Scotland now for 12 years, and they seem to be, so far as I can see, making rather a mess of it. I mean, they're basically made reorganizations in the police, which have flopped, reorganizations in the health service, which has flopped, failure to do anything much about education, so they're now falling behind by objectively, the PISA measurements. And Scotland used to pride itself on being ahead of the rest of us on that. And, one of the ways of avoiding talking about those problems is to bang on about independence. But they're now being told by Johnson 2 days ago that there's no way that the British government is going to agree to a second referendum. There will be a legal challenge to that. Undoubtedly, it will be turned down. And so, at some point or other, they're just going to have to return to the serious subject of running Scotland properly and effectively. Phil. I'm sorry.
I would just like to say, you have put certainly the most persuasive and general overview of the positive side of Brexit far better than any of the senior politicians who did actually in the last 7 years. Johnson you're seeing are the consequences of first past the post, yes. Past the post.
It's a wonderful electoral system. Well, Phil, I'm sorry for your loss. We did have a referendum in 2011 on changing the electoral system, and the proposals were comprehensively rejected. Every system of elections has got to bear in mind two things. First, well, three things. First of all, legitimacy. Does the population which uses the system basically accept the results of it? And here I make the point that any time you change the system, you diminish its legitimacy. The strongest source of legitimacy is tradition. We've been operating our electoral system like we have, and many of the English-speaking countries around the world have followed suit for some centuries. And it is a well-understood system. It delivers constituency representation, and it is, as the referendum in 2011 showed, broadly accepted by the British people as a matter of legitimacy. A second consideration is, as it were, responsiveness to sentiment. Now, there you have a case. The first past the post system is very punitive of third parties and other parties. So to that extent, they get underrepresented in the legislature. I agree that there is a bit of a case on representational grounds for PR. But then the third part of an electoral system is to sustain a government. And that is particularly important in Britain, where we have a unified system between executive and legislature. The effect of having PR would, I think, be gravely to undermine the capacity of government to govern. It was all explained to me very nicely by a Dutch Labour politician that I met when I was on the UK Netherlands Parliamentary Committee. He was a very clever man. He said, you know, in the Netherlands, we present our parties to the electorate, and then we negotiate afterwards and form a coalition. In Britain, you form the coalitions before the electorate, and then you present the conclusions of that to the electorate to make the choice. He still thought his system was better. I don't believe it is. I think that the British system of first past the post has legitimacy, it is adequately responsive to opinion, and it above all, as we now see, when it works properly, delivers powerful, effective, and sustained executive energetic government. So I hope we will not change the system. The Libs have just got to reorganize themselves. And frankly, you know, I listened with dismay and surprise to the last opportunity that Joe Swinson had to address the British public on the Today program, the day before the election. She had 8 or 9 minutes. More than half of her time she spent discussing transgenderism. Enough said. Well, first of all, about the experts, I think you've got to remember that in the referendum in 2016, George Osborne was effectively the leader of the Remain campaign, and he was a very aggressive and, to my mind, rather nasty campaigner. And he really G'd up the Treasury, very powerful department, and the Bank of England, a very powerful institution, and everybody else he could influence, which is a lot of people, to producing basically what had worked in the case of the Scottish referendum 2 years before, which was a very, very negative prognosis for the result of a vote to go in the wrong direction. Now, that had worked in Scotland. It had produced an absolutely dismal campaign. Everybody thought it was an absolutely frightful campaign. Why? Because it was entirely focused on economic issues and economic forecasts, including massive lies by the SNP with Alex Salmond, who, by the way, is going to be facing trial for multiple rapes next month. About Scottish oil, you know. Oil prices went like that after the referendum. They thought they would try the same tactic, Project Fear it was labelled, in the referendum of 2016. And that's why I think a lot of people were G'd up for it. And they gave themselves, they committed themselves to all sorts of incredibly sort of horrid prognoses, none of which have occurred. I mean, the striking thing over the 3 years since, in spite of all the turmoil and confusion and problems, has been that the British economy has actually stood up quite well through it. People noticed this, and they asked themselves the same question that you ask, and came to the conclusion that perhaps the experts were talking through their hat. Now, on the question of the youth, I haven't actually seen any breakdown, although no doubt it's all going to be done, of how people voted in terms of age. I think it's perfectly possible that the under 30s were more heavily for Remain than for Leave. On the whole, though, most of them don't vote. I think this has got to do with the hopes that youth entertains, maybe. It may have to do with the way in which people are now processed through higher education. And higher education has become very, very radicalized in Britain, as it has, I think, in this country too, in ways which one just hopes that the students, as they grow up and move out into the real wide world, realize that basically presenting a very false picture of the world. I think there's a lot of wokedom about, but I also notice a lot of anti-wokedom emerging. In 10 years' time, people who were 21 in this election year will be 31. And when you're 31, the world looks a bit different from how it looked when you were 21. Lady there? Well, I think they could have a they had a vote in the I'm not sure they had a vote in the referendum. Yes, they did. They did. And they can have a vote in the UK provided they were in the UK 15 years before. I'm a bit vague about the details of this. They certainly participated in, and I dare say they all of them would have voted to remain because it's the least disturbing to their position. But I believe that there's already been an agreement between the UK and Spain, who of course very anxious to keep all these good people. Like a lot of these problems, they look enormous when you sort of think about them in the abstract, but when you actually get into the details, they can be addressed quite satisfactorily.
The problem with rising is an utter word at the moment. It's the dreaded D word, debt. Debt in South Africa and under the federal debt, fiscal debt, municipal debt, government debt, and including the UK. Now, the last time we had the debt problem was only 10 years ago. Nobody forecasted, not the most prominent people in the world, but it's looming again. So any economic forecast now, you've got to be very brave.
Yeah. Well, that's a very good question, and I'm afraid I have to say that I put it on. This is a question about the impact on Britain and the world economy of the mounting tide of indebtedness that there exists, both in the public sector, corporate sector, and in private households. And that is a very real fact. And he also mentioned the question of the British trade deficit. I want to say something about that. I mean, all of this seems to me to fall under the heading of what Donald Rumsfeld had in mind when he talked about the known unknowns. I mean, we are moving into some fairly uncharted waters with this massive indebtedness. On the other hand, interest rates are dramatically low. And this is leading a lot of governments, including the British government, to feel that actually this is the time to spend and to borrow to spend, because if you can borrow it 4.2%, why not? Exactly. And, you know, so can you go on with QE and all those other things? A bit above my pay grade there, I have to say. I share your feeling that there may well be a bit of a day of reckoning. And I think that, you know, we will be hit by it, just by it, like everybody else. But I think the thing that really will be hit by it will be the European Monetary Union. Because that institution is, its foundations are in sand. It's a monetary union without an economic union, without a political union, without a transfer union. Because the Germans are never going to pay to compensate the southern Europeans for having lost their freedom to devalue their currencies against the Deutschmark. And that's the reason why Germany has this massive, massive trade surplus, and they sit on a mounting pile of gold, while Greece's economy has fallen by a third and the Italians are struggling. And so I think that, you know, all sorts of consequences will flow if and when there is a kind of debt crisis. On the question of the British trade deficit, I thought of raising that as one of our weaknesses. It may perhaps should be that it's a symptom of our weakness rather than one of the weaknesses. I mean, the classic economic theory, sort of going back to Adam Smith, is that trade balances don't matter if they're balanced in other ways. And the UK has a negative balance on exports of manufactured goods. I think we've run down our manufactured sector far too much. And I hope that one of the things we will do is slightly rebuild it under the USA dispensation. But we have compensated by growth in services. And we also get massive inward investment. I mean, we have more inward investment than any other economy apart from China. And that in China is going down. So, you know, in a sense, it's not an economic problem that we have this trade deficit. I think it's more a kind of political problem, because as you go on in that way, you lose more and more control of your economy. You end up in the position that, for example, Tony Blair made a rather good remark at a European summit once. He said, at number 10 Downing Street, we buy our electricity from a French company, and we buy our water from a German company, but no British company can sell either electricity or water anywhere in Europe. You know, so these problems are fairly long-standing. I just think that we'd be in a stronger position to address them within the framework of national control being re-established post-Brexit. Well, the part of the withdrawal agreement was effectively to reduce, we don't know by how much, to as negligible as possible a level, any kind of friction on the land border. Effectively, the customs border is going to be in the Irish Sea between Britain and Ireland as a whole, rather than between Northern Ireland and Southern Ireland. Needs to see how that works in practice. The situation in Ireland is quite interesting. I mean, a factor is that Sinn Féin have become quite an important player in the domestic electoral politics of the Republic. They're the third party and they are growing there. There is a needle match going on between Fine Gael, which is Radcliffe's party, and they've been traditionally the moderates, and Fianna Fáil, traditionally the ultras. And there's a question mark of who's going to win in the general elections coming up quite soon. I read quite an interesting piece in one of the papers saying that Varadkar was actually rather helped by a perception in Ireland that the name of the game now is moving from being beasted to the Brits, which he was rather, to being, you know, who's going to be best at being cuddling up to the Brits in the new period. And that Varadkar has some claims to that possibility. So we don't know how Ireland is going to work out. But I just think, you know, I don't think the Irish state is capable of absorbing a hostile 20% minority in the form of the Northern Ireland Protestants. If there were to be unification between the two parts, I dare say a lot of the Protestants would leave, which is, of course, what happened in the South, which has now got a tiny Protestant population. But a lot of it would stay, and they'd be a pretty serious pain in the arse for the Irish Republic. I think a sober-sided Irish politician, Irish elector, might well vote against unification in Northern Ireland if he was given the chance. And that, by the way, is the one thing that is provided for in the Good Friday Agreement. You know, to be honest, I can't answer that question. I mean, if you look at the fine print, which I haven't done, my impression is that there are some considerable improvements in that agreement, the Boris agreement. But to be honest, I always thought the whole issue was a very confected issue, stirred up by the European Union with the encouragement from our Remainers, and actively aided and abetted by Varadkar and the Irish, all designed to basically get us to sort of give up Brexit. And that's one of the reasons, I'm afraid perhaps rather laxly, I failed to address my mind to the technicalities of which particular phytophysical regulation would be operated where and in what place and how. I'm afraid it all went over my head.
If I could comment on that.
Yeah. It's, Phil, this is what is called flexibility. sorry? Ken. Hi, hello. Ken.
Robert, I was very happy that so much of your talk looked at the question of deindustrialization. But it seems to me that this is going to continue to be a problem after Brexit. And it's going to continue to be a problem so long as the emphasis is on a kind of free trade. And this is why the Trump administration and its ideological supporters, like Steve Bannon, are banging on about economic nationalism. And I think economic nationalism is on the rise in other parts of the world as well. And this has also been part of British history. I mean, it was the British who had the Methuen Treaty in the 18th century, which was one of the most notorious examples of a forcible use of trade to deindustrialize another country. So what I'm going to suggest is that this is going to continue to be a problem after Brexit. And it's been foreseen. And of course, ironically, on both sides, because it wasn't just the Bank of England, the other people who were predicting bad things as a result of Brexit. There were people who favoured Brexit, who were predicting deindustrialisation, notably Professor Binford, who thought that it would be a good thing. Little Britain needed to specialise in financial services. That was where it had its natural advantage. But the rest of us tend to think this is a bad thing, and of course young people tend to think it's a bad thing, and working people tend to think it's a bad thing. So it seems to me that Brexit is not solving the problem of deindustrialization, and it may actually make things worse. And but we're moving into a world where deindustrialization is becoming the number one issue for many, many countries.
Yes, Ken. I think that's a very good question, and it's one I really ponder within myself. I mean, intellectually, I'm a free trader. I think most people in Britain who think or thought about this are. But I also recognize, and there's been a debate that's run through British politics for a very long time, that there is a case for protectionism. it was a hugely divisive issue in the Tory party in the late 19th, early 20th century.
Yes.
Joe Chamberlain, Empire Free Trade versus the real free trade. This is what caused Winston Churchill to leave the Conservative Party and go to the Liberal Party. You know, so it's a very old debate in Britain. And my feeling about it is it was a mistake to run down our manufacturing sector as strongly as we did. We should have been more kind of supportive of it, as indeed other countries within Europe undergoing deindustrialization have been. Somebody gave me a very interesting example about shipbuilding. You know, now we have Harland & Wolff has basically become a leisure shopping center. But, you know, in Italy, for example, they're building huge quantities of boats that go on these river cruises. And how they do that? Well, in the Italian manner, they've got banks that are prepared to lend money at very low interest rates with the state standing quietly in the background, or illegal under EU rules. But nevertheless, Viking builds its boats in Italy, not in Britain. We could be doing much more. And I hope that one of the catalytic shock effects of Brexit maybe that we will re-examine some of these issues. But as a broad general proposition, I think that the British interest is to operate in the, to move towards the freest possible international markets, to be prepared to accept that there's a logic in that, but then to be much more vigorous in kind of exploring how, within the details of the working out of that logic, you can minimize the damage that is done. And that's, I think, going to be a big task for the government ahead. Jeremy? Well, I don't really know enough about it to give a good answer, except I will just say this, that you know, one of the consequences of Brexit is that the British are now looking much more seriously at all those sort of relationships with rest of the world countries than we have done for a long time. You know, where basically the name of the game was to get yourself into Europe. Over the last 10 years, that's been correcting itself quite significantly, as I suggested. And one of the places we're bound to be looking is South Africa. Africa at large. I mean, Africa is, you know, potentially it presents huge problems to the world. It's going to be, it's the only part of the world where the world population is going to continue to increase. It's also going to be one of the parts of the world that's most affected by climate change, negatively affected by climate change. I think there's a lot of trouble brewing, but there are also many opportunities because, you know, basically the educational revolution is sort of beginning to catch on in Africa. There's potential for a very large consumer market. There's potential for all kinds of economic partnerships to emerge. And I don't see any particular reason why the British shouldn't be very well placed to take advantage of those possible connections. And I hope we will. I voted to remain, by the way.
The other thing is this very positive outlook for Britain post-Brexit, and it was put forward in a very convincing way, so congratulations to you. However, I've got one point that is ambition versus reality, and when I look at the British government stands at the moment, it is a very young, inexperienced government. There are some lightweights like Sajid Javid, Dominic Raab. Even Boris Johnson has got a doubtful track record in senior positions. So can the British public really trust this government that this potential that you positive picture of that is there, that this can really be achieved with this kind of government?
Well, yes, I agree with you. You know, I'm not a great fan of Dominic Raab. I believe he's known as Dim Dom. But I haven't heard Sajid Javid described as a lightweight. I think he's quite a serious figure. By the way, it's an interesting point to note that not only was the Conservative Party the first party in Britain to supply not just one but two female prime ministers, but it's also in the senior positions in government, the prime minister is, well, he's disqualified because he's an old Etonian, but we have the son of a Pakistani bus driver as Chancellor of the Exchequer, and the daughter of a Hindu immigrant from Uganda as the Home Secretary. It's pretty remarkable when you think about it. No, I mean, it is a pretty well a new administration. That's a very interesting point. It is a new administration, although the Conservatives have been in power for 10 years. And that's part of Boris's magic, that he's somehow creating the impression of a new government. Whether they'll be up to it, well, no government is ever up to it. I think the objective factors that I was trying to put my finger on are there to help us. Things could go badly wrong because of international developments of a kind that were referred to in an earlier question, the impact of indebtedness, the changes in the trade cycle. But you know, the government has a very strong political position now, and I think it's got capable people in it within the ranks of the Conservative Party. I've always been impressed by, I mean, I left Parliament in 2005. I think the level of the Conservative Party average MP has considerably improved since then. So, you know, good luck to them is what I say. I think the European Union, the question is the European Union going to be emerging as a separate pole in sort of French style, or whether it basically continues to be, but in a more sincere and cooperative way, part of a Western grouping. I mean, that's what it actually is. I mean, you know, Europe depends on the United States and to some extent on Britain for its defense. I mean, it's contracted that out, as if defense no longer matters. They don't seem to notice what's happening in Russia. Putin is actually developing rather a threatening position. But so far, it hasn't played into European politics at all. And meanwhile, you know, the opportunity which was provided for in the original GATT, the founders of GATT anticipated the emergence of European unification, and they actually provided for the possibility of suspending the most favored nation clause in favor of political construction of federal entities like the European Union. I don't think that anybody could really have foreseen the way in which those provisions have been abused to create very strong protectionist positions in Europe, which are, I think, indefensible in the multilateral system. And I think the next years are going to see a big confrontation, particularly if Trump wins, which I think he will. I think the Germans in particular are going to have to think again about the sweet spot which they've created for themselves, where they don't really have to pay anything very much, but get huge benefits. So I see the West, in my bipolar scenario, the West is regrouping around the leadership of the United States, with China and Russia together, in a particularly probably increasingly foul arrangement between the two of them, which will eventually crack because those kinds of systems always do. Well, I'll come back to that in a moment. First, about Trump. I mean, you know, opinions greatly differ about Trump. For some people, he's just a great big narcissistic baby, destructive, and, you know, needs to be put back into his cot. And other people see what Kissinger said he saw after he met Trump just after he was elected. He said, well, he didn't go to any of the schools we went to, and he's never studied international relations like we have done. But he does have a point of view and quite a lot of experience, and it's all quite fresh and could be quite interesting. And I'm with Kissinger. I think there's a wrecking side to Trump, but I think there's also a constructive side. And so far as the Middle East is concerned, what I notice is that he's effectively abandoned a failed American strategy, which was, you know, in alliance with Britain to kind of impose America's will by force in the Middle East. And he's now moved to an alternative strategy, which doesn't really require him to consult us, although it would be nice and polite if he did, which is to build up a position of strength in alliance with Saudi Arabia and Israel over against Iran, and to crack the Iranian nut. That's what he's doing. The Russians have gained a bit of a toehold, regained a toehold in Syria, but then, you know, the Syrian battle was really lost under Obama. Whenever you go into the details of Trump in terms of strategic developments, I find there's something quite serious and quite coherent there. He may not even know it, but I think it is there. Now, as far as the NHS is concerned, first of all, I think the idea that we should have much more private contracting into the NHS has been accepted by both parties now for at least 20 years. And it already includes American companies, and I don't see any reason why there shouldn't be more scope for American companies to participate on a contractual basis in a contracted out NHS system. It all gets quite technical if you don't know about the NHS. The other thing is, there is a long-standing gripe by the American pharmaceutical companies about the monopsonistic system of drug procurement in America, in Britain, where we use the buying power of the NHS to basically leverage down the price we pay for American pharmaceutical developments. Now, I think that's to my mind, that's to some extent negotiable. We already do it. Something called the pharmaceutical price regulation scheme. Every 5 years, it's reviewed. Companies have to say, they have to justify the price they want to charge the NHS in terms of the amount of research they're doing, amount of research they're spending in the UK. All those factors are recognised in negotiations with the particular companies. We could have perhaps be a bit more generous to the American companies in those negotiations. I mean, if you want to make a big deal of it, like Jeremy Corbyn tried, you can. I mean, you know, the whole thing's going to be sold out to the Americans. But I just remember Trump's rather clever remark that he wouldn't buy the NHS if it was offered him on a silver plate.
The Lisbon Treaty, Sabaton did not attempt to escape Europe. Will they now be able to try again?
Sorry, the
Lisbon Treaty sabotaged Denmark's attempt to escape.
I think one of the effects of Brexit has been that actually quite strong Eurosceptical sentiment in many continental countries slightly chilled and cooled. And I think one of the reasons why Brussels actually was really quite beastly and rather rude to us was because they wanted, in the famous words of Voltaire about Admiral Byng, encourager les autres. I don't think that Denmark has been particularly in that way. What's happened in Denmark is that Danish politics have shifted dramatically to the right into a kind of attitude which is very, very critical of the degree of penetration of alien immigrants. But I think Danish Euroscepticism, which is a factor, has been contained. But I think the problem for the Europeans is that the monetary union, this is what I talked about last year, the monetary union is it's fundamentally unstable. And the cost to the southern European countries of adjusting to living and competing within a system which is effectively the old Deutschmark, without the capacity to ease the position by devaluations, is dramatic. And what's going on in France at the moment is absolutely central to this. And the French have unit labor costs that are higher than those in Germany. Their welfare state is far too expensive and unaffordable. Juppé and Chirac tried to cure it in the 1990s. They retreated in the face of strikes. The problems continued to grow. Macron is making an attempt to refix it. He's retreating now already. They cannot sustain the arrangements or welfare state transfers at the same time as a fixed exchange rate with Germany. The consequence of that continuing tension, I think, is going to be continuing and growing Euroscepticism in Italy, Salvini, in France, Madame Le Pen. I think this is a story whose the final chapters of which have yet to be written. Anybody else? Is that Ivan?
Yes.
Oh, hi. Well, I think thank you for telling me, I haven't seen that yet. I think it rather fits into my view of how these negotiations are going to go, that basically the focus will be on finding ways around the problems of the sort of pan-European integrated production processes, particularly in automotives and aircraft. Parts and pharmaceuticals and such. So rather immediate nitty-gritty problems about how to get, you know, the widget that you have to have in the engine, which is made in Bremen, and the engine is being made in Liverpool before it goes on to have some extra bit put into it in Madrid or wherever. You know, that's the system we've got at the moment. It's important for everybody that it shouldn't be disrupted, and we can hopefully do a deal on that basis.
He's saying those manufacturers do not stay in lockstep because you're going to be wrong.
Well, you read the interview and I haven't. My impression is that it's going to be important to find ways of enabling the wings that are being made for Airbus to be transported across the border so they can get to Toulouse without too much hassle. Frankly, I don't see why that should be very difficult. And I just hope that such sort of arrangement will be reached. Whether it requires a great panoply of alignments and agreements of the four freedoms and all the other claptrap that the Europeans talk about, I think is doubtful. And I think that Javid may be making that point. I mean, you don't have to have free movement of labor in order to have free trade. It's the connection between those two is entirely a totally European kind of invention. Ken.
I'd like to come back on a slightly different note, thinking about your last remarks regarding Remainers.
Yeah.
And I do think there is actually a very considerable problem here of Remainers who are feeling that they've lost their country. And it's this feeling which many people in the north of England had, which was one of the things which led to Brexit. So I see a certain parallel here. And having a group of people, particularly young people, who are feeling alienated, culturally alienated, and unrepresented, and their arguments disregarded, this is not a good situation.
I agree with you, Ken.
I think it's one which you can't just ask people to accept it and grin and bear it. And I worry about it particularly in the long run because of the alternative being immigration. I've been struck by this. A handful of cases, three people I know, young people, wanting to leave Britain. If one of the consequences of Brexit is actually going to be a brain drain, particularly among bright, young, highly educated people, this is going to be a serious downside.
I agree with you about this. I mean, I think it is painful that there is this division. You know, we've seen this before. I mean, I think that, for example, the relationship of a large part of our intelligentsia and the Soviet Union in the 1930s, 40s, and 50s was quite a serious problem for us. Produced the Cambridge spies. And if we go further back, of course, the whole business of Rome, the papists, very divisive, formative issue in British politics in the 17th and 18th centuries, even into the 19th century. And it's painful when there are those divisions. But, you know, they're part of the facts of life. I'm not sure that huge command can be done except to be attentive and concerned. But I do actually think some of the Remainers have got to grow up a bit. I mean, some of the stuff I read in The Guardian, it's really, you know, Bill Hutton, he's taken leave of his senses. Tim Garton Ash, I mean, you know, grief. Grief may be, but I mean, this is worse than grief. It's actually tearing your cheeks and pulling out your hair, shrieking, and I mean, behaving like a, you know, one of those sort of North Korean crowds on the death of King, what's his name? You know, it is overdone. And as I say, one of the things that I've always struck about with those people is how little they sort of know about Europe as the European Union. I mean, my favorite party game, I always try not to be provocative, is to say, well, tell me three European policies that you like. And they sort of, you know, what European policies, what are they? And then, so I sort of throw out a bit of a lifeline. I say, what about the common agricultural policy? It's their most important policy. Do you think that's a very good idea? What the damage it does to third world agriculture, the high levels of protection, the high cost of food it imposes on European consumers, particularly the poorer ones. Or maybe you favor the monetary union. You think that's such a great success. You know? And so, you know, you can have a very, very good conversation with some of these characters. And usually...
It can be said of people who voted Brexit.
Well, maybe.
Exactly.
Maybe. But on the whole, you know, the Brexiteers tended to be rather better informed about Europe than the Remainers. They had the strength of that. Because they've been campaigning at it for such a long time.
They wrote the sign on the bus.
They wrote the sign on the bus. Well, it's quite time since I was involved in these matters, but I just make two comments. First of all, it is true that in respect of research funding, we were major beneficiaries of the EU budget. But all that has to be put in the context of the overall contribution of Britain, which is the point about the bus. And that was 10 billion a year. 10 billion a year net contribution, net of receipts. Science was one of the few sectors where we actually got more back than we put in. Overall, we were putting in roughly £1 billion a month it actually works out more as accurately to this figure that was on the side of the bus. The cost of Europe to Britain since we joined, we've been net contributed in every year since we joined, is something of the order of £400 billion. We've only had a trade surplus in 1 year of that whole period. Last year, our trade deficit with the EU was £95 billion. I asked myself how enthusiastic the Germans, for example, would have been if they were paying as much as we paid and also had massive trade deficits every year with the rest of the European Union. So I think that just puts the science thing on in perspective. There will be a lot of resource that will not be going to Europe, which is available, among other things, to continue to fund science. And one thing that is clear about this government is they seem to have got the point about science. They do talk about it. Let's hope they'll put their money behind it. The other observation, which I'm afraid is perhaps rather prejudicial, but when I was involved in this, I was very struck by the way in which huge amounts of money were being spent in these European projects to kind of, you know, maintain the facade of European unity. We've got to have some Bulgarians. We have to have a bit of money for the Hungarians. You know, Portugal should be fitted in. You know, these projects were being tailored with the objective of European integration in mind, just as much as the objection of the advancement of science. That's not a bad thing, but it was not uncostly. Yeah. Well, I've never met him. He sounds like one of those people that you do actually need, you know, the sort of... There's a lovely remark of Baldwin, apropos of Lloyd George. Stanley Baldwin said, Mr. Lloyd George is a dynamic force, and a dynamic force is a terrible thing. There's a place for those sort of people. He undoubtedly was an architect of the 2016 referendum, and he's an architect of Johnson's victory. And hats off to him. As a philosopher of government and contributor to the reorganization of British government, I think he's rather a marginal figure. I think we do have problems in our civil service. They do need to be addressed. I think the quality of public service in Britain has declined. I don't think the Cummings approach is the right one. There is a place for nerds and geeks, but I don't think that they should be running the show.
Whoop. Sorry, I just wanted to ask you, is there a precedent for referenda in the UK to only have a 50%, or was the Brexit one the first one? And if so, did that not necessarily...